one thing that you're working on and a different theory of change is another thing that you're working on. Okay, and this workshop is loosely based on a workshop that was designed by the Change Agency, a couple of people called James Whelan and Tanya Newman at Climate Camp in 2010. If you're interested, I can send you some stuff afterwards. Okay, are there any questions about the general why we're here? Okay, any questions about, still don't get, really get what theory of change is? Cool. So, I think it would be good to just get an idea of who's in the room. So if we could go around relatively rapidly, but just say your name, if you have an organisational affiliation, what it is, and what's been your highlight of the day so far. And maybe we can start with you, Nick.
I'm Nick, I'm a medical student. My highlight of the day so far was actually the third lecture on global health watch, and that's a bit on economics.
I'm Hannah. I just finished my master's in global public health at Queen Mary. I currently work for a charity called National Numeracy. My highlight of the day was the last discussion panel.
I'm Caroline, I'm a student in Global Health and Development at UCL, and my highlight of the day was probably the talk by Ron on the title.
I'm Jackie, I'm a GP, and my highlight of the day was actually going like I understood some of
I'm Jenny, junior doctor from Shire.
Through the rank of the room, that's where it comes from. My highlight of the day is talking to my interest
and Matt, I'm a medical student at UCL. I think my highlight was Ron's array of terrifying statistics that hopefully be motivated in Ron's
experience.
Hi, my
name is Kira, I'm a medical student in Bristol. I think my highlight is
my name's Sarah, I'm working in public health in South East London, and my highlight of the day was Thomas Lavalle's talk around their organisation journey.
Thomas Gebauer, and I'm expecting, I'm expecting the highlight coming from this meeting.
I'm Ruth, and I'm a trustee of both Medact and HPA, and the highlight for me has been the way the whole thing's come together, and I think the bits have followed on very nicely to give us an overall picture of the problem and some of the solutions and some of the ways to organise around it. And my other highlight, I have to say, is to see some of the young people. Mm-hmm. That's what we need. We need you all. It's great.
I'm Ariel. I'm a Global Public Health Master's student at Queen Mary. I work in the addictions field as doing service improvement work, and I co-lead a festival welfare organisation called Welfare Enough. The highlight for me today has been around various speakers talking about taxation and more effective ways to gain capital through those legitimate means, because that's something that's very interesting to me.
I'm Sepida. I'm a public health registrar from Manchester. I've not had one highlight particularly. I've enjoyed all the various discussions coming together and just the general feeling of challenging the status quo, which we don't really hear in discourse otherwise.
I'm Julia. I'm doing Masters at LSE International Health Policy, and my highlight was, I think, Ron Lamonte's speech.
Yeah. My name is Julia. I'm a junior doctor from London, but I'm studying and working in Liverpool, and probably the highlight was that I came because I'd gone to a couple of days a different conference earlier on in the week, and I thought I was conferenced out. But I did check the programme last night, and I was like, fine, okay. But I think what's hard is that you get, you know, it's kind of hard to transfer like all this information and everything into deciding where you're going to put your time and your thoughts, because there's so many possible criticisms of each thing you can look at and possible wonderful things, and just to kind of try and work out how to kind of move forward with one of them. But I was also going to say the austerity bites thing, having lived in like Toxteth, which is not Croxteth, but similar in Liverpool, sometimes you feel like this could sound terrible, but like they might not know about UK Uncut or whatever, but you kind of think like if you are going to sit there and feel very aggrieved, then you should find out about these situations, because if you think that you want to have a kind of second coming thing, then get involved with people that are already doing stuff in a structured way, rather than just saying, oh, this is terrible, but that probably sounds really critical. But I don't know what to look for. But,
I'm Fiona Wright. I'm currently teaching on a global health degree and master's at Queen Mary's. Before that, I've been working many years as a public health doctor in London. And my highlight for the day was Thomas's speech and some of the sort of unusual creative thinking he had. For example, around the roles of something that's always been a bugbear for me is about how charities are always seem like a good thing, but they're actually picking up the stuff that the state should be doing.
Hi, I'm Rosemary, retired GP and long-term member of Medact. And I was particularly interested in what Tom had to say about Medico and how it's been going for so long and has and is obviously so successful, and thinking potentially for Medact and learning about how we might take the position.
I'm Diana. I'm a GP and currently thinking how to forward green politics and people's health movement together. And my highlight was the light bulb moment when strategic structural adjustment is the same as austerity. Yes, why didn't I see that already?
Is there one other person who just came in? Yes. What's your name and organisation affiliation, and what was your highlight of today?
Sure, I'm Anuj Kapila from me, and I'm a lecturer at the Institute for National Health and Development. I'm also a member of the Fields of England. And highlight, I think the
going off in lots of different directions and get lose an anchor. So it's quite good to find an anchor at the beginning of the workshop. So what we're going to do, if you all get comfortable, I'm going to ask you to close your eyes, and then I'm going to ask you to, I'm just going to kind of take you through thinking about whatever issue it is that you're passionate about and that you want to change, or whatever problem you want to change. So if you don't have seats, there's some down here. Think about the impacts of this problem. Who is impacted upon and how? Who benefits from it, from the situation currently, and how? So you might want to think about the employment that might be generated and the profits. Created. What decisions were made, and who made those decisions? And what's maintaining the status quo? How is this problem persisting? How is power created and maintained? Think about consent and authority. In relation to this problem, think about power held by government, by industry, and by communities. And how is that power created and maintained? What would it take to change those power relations?
Yeah. And then the thing is, I've got healthy relationships and connections. A better world emerges after.
Strong relationships are necessary ingredients for a better society. Methods are dialogue processes, and networking is joint efforts.
Thank you.
matins. Christian said to peace.
Peacekeeping or strict observations, nations,
just the Gandhi.
I like this. I mean, I think it's a nice thing, but I'm reading Lucifer's book right now about this type of prison experiment. Volunteers were divided into groups, first one of them were prisoners, another they were there, prisoners and guards.
Oh, they were shocking them or something?
No, this is a different, it's the same idea. They basically took a bunch of students and they assigned them to the other prisoners and guards. They said this is an office building for it's meant to be for a week. And then they just stopped after the assigned day to imagine people they weren't trained to they started really dehumanizing and torturing people as prisoners. It's all about how power corrupts.
Yes, it is about. So I mean, I like it, but it's really difficult to implement it.
How would reducing violence get reverse the austerity?
It's not always directly translated, but as well as it can also bring up the concept of injustice. It's actually applied to structural injustice as well.
So what is the question? What is your question doing?
How are you talking about violence?
And not the people in that impact, but violence has this whole surrounding structural culture, doesn't it? It's hard to make people non-violent without taking them out of that whole cultural fact. Because if someone else has got a new club, we're not going to get rid of ours.
Again, I think
from this class that I took years ago, this can work, but has to be combined with other ones. Just sort of Santiago is not sufficient, you know?
And then we'll take time. Lots of time.
Increasing minimum wage, that kind of stuff, right?
Yeah.
Wage, reducing the maximum number of people working out of the just doesn't grab people.
I feel like this is one of the main things, but it doesn't kind of get to the how. It's got the method, but how do you do that?
That's kind of classic thing to the lobbying, like the letter writing, the lobbying, the pressure groups. A lot of it don't particularly use it, or maybe we underuse on this stuff. The Green Party, right?
Yeah. I suppose that's
But then if we had to do that, then I don't know, would it be
it doesn't work, but actually
it does work. That's how they changed it at working out the doctors or we don't know.
That's an hiding in plain sight. Underappreciated.
Reliable institutions that guarantee
idea of institutional development theory that I have is institutional development theory in my
racial theory.
But I mean, it's a little bit different. This is about here, it's like private institutions that guarantee democracy, community justice. Yes, I mean, you should try to do this, but probably you should be waiting for some kind of corruption stuff.
So I feel like maybe the issue was Ebola. This might be one of the solutions to develop governance that were equitable, that would actually make shit more corrupt. They should finally get to the hospital and the hospital to deliver something like that. But again, it doesn't perhaps. It's like, oh yeah, yeah, we can make the government
is that kind of mini and some mini and
so it doesn't seem to address it. Government is corrupt as well, but why are they corrupt? It doesn't address what where it's situated and what like that. And if we don't address that, then it might go corrupt again. I'm hoping that maybe the next one's actually going to address what you just said.
Yeah.
like the drinks and food company, like McDonald's. So instead of trying to legislate, it's like bringing the going, oh, we'll reduce our sugar levels a bit, or reduce our salt levels.
Yeah.
Or like carbon tablets.
So I see
that
as a way of getting
yeah.
And then
it can make
sense. They're so powerful.
But then
just
giving them back their point.
They have the power anyway, so you might as well find a way to negotiate.
Exactly.
Oh, actually, it's similar to what is the grassroots mobilization theory. When the people lead, the leaders will follow. If we mobilize enough opposition to the problem, leaders will have to pay attention. Methods mobilize grassroots groups and violence their direct action, use of the media, education, efforts, organizing, so it's, yeah, so this one, the other one actually similar.
So
it's
a Russell Brand
yeah,
or a head of whatever. But then that reveals the kind of anyone that knows about that reveals kind of qualified. It's like whether it's like learned, it's like to do with. As a lawyer, ages ago they made a drama about it, it was assassinated by the government. Anyway, that kind of thing where like it reveals their brutality by like, firing him, it shows something,
yeah.
Isn't it?
Gandhi-style.
The economics theory. People make personal decisions, and so decision makers make policy decisions based on a system of rewards or incentives and punishments or sanctions that are essentially economic. If you change the economics, you can bring about change. So you use governmental financial institutions to change supply and demand dynamics.
And for me, that's really relevant.
There's quite essentially a lot of money to be made. There are like more money on the
I think like having certain financial penalties or incentives to the way that they do things.
When something is illegal, it's fundamentally unregulated. You can't make it legal. Once you've legalized it, then it's regulated. It's money. So it's a commodity that's already there.
Many injustices are partly motivated by prejudice, misrepresentation, and the media to change public methods, TV and radio programs, social media campaigns, modeling preferred behavior, symbolic acts.
I'm not sure about economic theory for me. It's like, I think it's
interesting.
Yeah, it's a as a barman here, it's like just for me, the economic theory is merely a tool. I like this so much that the especially sounds and the core ideas of how things should be done. The economic theory is merely showing you a tool how it can be done, how it can be supported. That's why. I don't believe in efficient markets. As most of the actual policymakers don't believe that. Apart from USA, I think that. I can try to explain you. Well, there are too many things happening. For now, for my master's, I have value health. It's like behavioral economics for health. How people value and elicit their health states, etc. It's so funny. It's so crazy. How do you value their health? I mean, how would you value, for example, living for 20 years with migraine 4 hours per
versus being out
8 years? Versus being in full health but living less. How much years you will be ill?
Would you rather like you definitely die or maybe die?
Yes. Yeah.
say you're fake for free.
Went to the BMJ for a sabbatical and never left, and eventually started doing more and more investigative journalism. Now, I'll kind of run through, want this to be interactive, to ask as many questions as you want, because the thing is with investigative journalism is I can't do my job without you guys. All my sources are academics, lawyers, doctors, campaigners, who've kind of found information that they don't quite know what to do with. And possibly it's legally a bit unsafe, and so stick it in the hands of me and then we can see what we can do. Now, just quickly, what's the point of, what is the main aim of investigative journalism?
Bring people's attention to things that they might not know are happening or have happened.
Yeah.
Awareness, I guess.
Yeah. Anything else? When you go through your journalism training, you start off with kind of, you know, an ideology that you are going to speak truth to power. So that really, if you're going to kind of, in the purest sense, that is where it kind of, you know, starts, should really start and end. You know, I'm working on a story at the moment that I'm kind of putting to bed, and it really is a case of who's calling the shots in this country. But briefly, what do you think are the main things that govern what I can and can't do as a journalist?
Really, the law comes in.
Law, absolutely, 100%. Lawyers say to me, I can and can't do. Now, has everyone heard of something called defamation? Defamation, I mean, there's other things like, I don't know whether anyone saw the panorama the other day on the fake shake who did undercover stings. If you're going to do undercover work, which I have done, there's other kind of laws that come into it, and that's subterfuge. So you have to have prima facie evidence of wrongdoing if you're going to engage in subterfuge. So, and which in healthcare, I have to say, and a lot of our defence in law is public interest. Now, health is about as good as it gets in terms of public interest defence. Because if you are establishing something is compromising health, damaging health, then that kind of stands up in court pretty strongly. Now, law, defamation. Have you ever heard of Simon Singh?
Yeah.
Someone called Peter Wilmshurst, he was a cardiologist that was pursued by a, and this is kind of the ridiculousness of our defamation law. He was pursued, he was involved in a clinical trial to do with a device that's implanted into the heart to close patent for Omron Avali. And that was specifically looking at its impact on migraines. So its outcome measure was the impact on migraines. And various dodgy things went on in the trial. He didn't believe it worked. He gave a quote. Now, this device was made by an American company called NMT. Now, he gave a quote to a Canadian newspaper about this trial. He was then pursued in the courts in London by an American company for a quote he'd given to Canada. Kind of a ridiculous situation, really. And then that kind of sparked a campaign. Simon Singh got involved with The Guardian because he'd written about chiropractics and The Guardian described the practice as bogus when it came to treating things like childhood asthma. And again, he was pursued by the British Chiropractic Association for defamation. So it ended up basically all going to the House of Lords, and things changed actually to support science, which is a good thing for us. So there was a new Act, Defamation Act 2013, that had new provisions in it to protect the freedom of science and scientific speech. Now, there are certain measures that I can take now, that we take a lot, certainly with my investigations that help protect. Everything gets put through peer review. So, I mean, we haven't quite used that as a test case yet in terms of journalism. It's supposed to be about academic research, because we've had to reject stuff as a journal because potentially it's defamatory. And in fact, one of the longest ever lawsuits involving defamation actually involved the BMJ in the 1960s, which involved a practice, quite an obscure practice, that someone wrote a paper on. There was only one person that did it in the country, and they said it was defamatory of them. Anyway, so what that means is we can put things through peer review to protect it. And the reason I'm telling you this is because it really does govern everything you can and can't do. There's another provision in it which is probably one of the best things in terms of standing up to corporations. Well, there's two things. First of all, the corporation, and a lot of my stuff is drug companies and device companies. They are the gift that keeps on giving, I'm afraid. And then, you know, tobacco, alcohol, food. Basically, I tend to write about corporations. So there's two things. First of all, they have to demonstrate a loss of earnings based on the investigation or the claim, which is quite hard to do, really, because you think about all the different things that impact on earnings of a company. Except occasionally when you do an investigation, I've done it with GSK and seen the share price drop the following day, and it's kind of squeaky bum time. If you've got anything wrong, that's when you know you're going to get hit. But there's another thing which I think is possibly even more important. Has anyone heard of privilege? What privilege is, it's law. So in the House of Commons, politicians can say anything they want, anything defamatory. So they could accuse someone of being a murderer in the House of Commons, and they can't get sued, so it's to enable freedom of debate. It's amazing we kind of have applied this to Parliament and court, but not applied it to kind of elsewhere. So what you might, in days of all, you might have heard is someone saying, like, come outside the House or come outside the chambers and say this outside. Because if you repeat that defamation outside, you can be sued. So that's what happens. It also happens in court. So if you think about the Oscar Pistorius trial, say, for example, all the things that were being alleged about him, in court, you could report on it freely. You know, he's murdered and he's done this and he's done that. And you can report on it freely. Protection. People can say what they want in court. Obviously, there's all the kind of legal aspects about what you can and can't say in court, and, you know, truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, and all that kind of thing. But you can report on it freely with immunity. Now, the BMJ have been sued. And has anyone heard of someone called Matthias Rath? Matthias Rath is a German guy.
that kind of convinced, he's one of the people behind Tarbo and Mecky's insistence that HIV didn't cause AIDS. Now, what happened was he's a German guy, basically he sold vitamin supplements, and so he was trying to sell vitamin supplements to people in South Africa and take them off their antiretrovirals. And Treatment Action Campaign South Africa were kind of up in arms about him. Ben Goldacre did stuff in The Guardian about him. Now what happened, he was being sued in Germany. And what happened in Germany was he persuaded the family with a kid with cancer that the kid should come off the chemo and take the vitamin supplements instead. The child died. So the German government stepped in and took him to court. Now, what happened in that court case, the BMJ had a reporter reporting there. The judge said outside the courtroom that Matthias Rath was a fraudster. Headline in the BMJ news article, Matthias Rath is a fraudster, says judge. Except he didn't say it in the courtroom, he said it outside the courtroom. So we got sued. Now, he issued a writ. We had Treatment Action Campaign South Africa throwing information at us to try and defend it. But we couldn't defend the fraudster bit strong enough, so we ended up having to settle for £100,000. He then used that money to take out adverts in the Metro and have a valedictory kind of lecture in East London saying how the naturopathic community had defeated the pharmaceutical BMJ and the pharma doctor world, which was quite interesting. Ben and I kind of went undercover and recorded the speech, and then he used that when Matthias Rath tried to sue Ben. So it's all quite interesting. That's just the kind of, in a nutshell, the kind of things that you kind of get up to.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
The fact, it was true that the judge had actually said that.
Yeah.
So the fact that you were reporting the truth wasn't an adequate defence?
No, because we were reporting what the allegation the judge had made about Rath. So reporting, just blindly reporting what someone else says isn't enough. So this is one of the biggest things that I do, is look for documentary evidence to support any allegation I make. So I look for prima facie evidence that will stand up in court. We probably could have pushed it, but the amount in legal fees it would have cost us would have run into millions to pursue it.
So he used the South African evidence to be prima facie, and then said, so we reported what he said, but we've got the evidence to say he is, that's not good enough.
In this instance, it was all balance of odds, and whether the amount it would have cost us to pursue would have cost millions. So that is why you don't sue lightly. Suing costs an absolute fortune. And he had backers, he's got wealthy backers, and it would have cost us millions of BMA, I'm sure the British Medical Association would be pleased about that, of BMA kind of BMJ money to pursue that. And we were advised that the evidence, we could have gone to trial, and even still we might have lost, and then we'd have had to incur his expenses as well.
And would it have made a difference if the judge had written that statement?
No, it would have been fine if he'd just said it in the courtroom.
No, but if he'd written it outside the courtroom?
No. So what this means is that same law. So you can say anything you want in a courtroom and in Parliament, yeah? Now, that's same, and that's what you call privilege. So you can say what you want in those places. Because imagine if you couldn't say what you needed to say in a courtroom. You know, imagine what would happen to kind of, the judicial system. Or in Parliament.
Sorry. Would he not have sued the judge as well for saying it?
He could have done.
But he chose not to.
He chose to come after us.
Because you're
working. Yeah, because we've got more, where the publication. You can sue the individuals. Simon Singh got sued with the British Chiropractic Association. Mm. And you can also sue the Guardian. The British Chiropractic Association went out of Simon Singh. So sometimes you go for who you're going to have more damage. There's going to be more damage. And he wanted to kind of say, probably no interest of him suing the judge. It's more interesting to say, they want to defeat the kind of, traditional medical world. That's kind of where they see their position. So him taking on what he sees as traditional medicine, Western medicine as the BMJ, was a bigger coup. Mm. So we ended up having to settle.
So can I just clarify that? So that you can say what you like in Parliament or in a court, and then as a reporter, you can report on any of that as long as it's said in Parliament or court.
Yes. Now, this privilege, and this is why I brought this up, this privilege is now being extended to scientific conferences. So, if you have a scientific conference, you, for example, one of the big things I report on is bearing kind of harms in clinical trials. So you imagine, in a kind of academic conference, you can put your hand up and kind of say, I think you have not reported evidence in your clinical trial. And I could report that.
that as a reporter.
Yeah.
So this is what the Defamation Act is now
defined as a scientific conference. You have three people in a room and stuff.
Well, that's it, and this is all case law, you see. So if you're at a big conference like the European Association of Study, I mean, that goes without saying. But then how you define what that scientific conference is all going to be subject to case law. And if anyone's going to wade into the middle of things, it's going to be me. Given, because there aren't that many places that do scientific kind of investigative kind of journalism. And I'm just telling you, because it just gives you a little bit of background of how you have to be sure. And what my job is when people come and make these allegations, my job is as an investigative journalist, is A, to assess the source, B, to check the validity of the source, and C, try and substantiate the allegations that are being made. And that is kind of one of the key things of the job. So, story I did the other week was, and there are lots of different ways about doing that, and this is where the likes of you guys come in. I'm not very undercover. So if I go and ask someone a question, it's very much about putting stuff on the record. I have use of press officers. If I want to, let's say if I go and ask GSK a question, it's very much on the record. And they know, if I ask them a question and they don't respond, I will say, BMJ asked GSK this question and they did not respond. Now you as readers can read into that what you will, depending on the context. So what key part of my job is to substantiate. Now, first story we did, has everyone heard of Tamiflu? Influenza drug, worked very closely with the Cochrane. Everyone heard of Cochrane collaboration? But very closely with Cochrane. And they, in 2009, they were asked to update their meta-analysis into the use of neuraminidase inhibitors, which included oseltamivir, Tamiflu, zanamivir, which is Relenza, made by GSK, Tamiflu, made by Roche, for use in pandemic. And it had been licensed here to not only to decrease the duration of influenza symptoms, but also to reduce hospitalizations by 50% and secondary complications. Now you can imagine in an influenza pandemic, if you can reduce hospitalizations, that's great, isn't it, in terms of health service burden. So they were asked to update their meta-analysis that had supported this. 2006 they did one, they were updating it. They were paid by the NIHR, the National Institutes of Health Research, and the Australian equivalent to update it. And what they realised when they started to try and get the trial data is they couldn't get it. So they looked at one review article. There's one review article that made these really bold allegations, and they just incorporated it into their previous meta-analysis. What they realised when it came down to it, only 2 of those 10 trials had ever been published. So they came to us and said, what do we do? Then as academics, they started embarking on, and because the kind of people that were involved in this particular Cochrane review were quite tenacious, they started to email, first of all, they emailed the lead author of this review article and said, can we have your primary data? Your individual page or whatever data you did this on, sure enough, you can produce it. Oh, I'll have to go and speak to Roche. I don't think I can produce it. Then they went to the two other trials that were published. One was in The Lancet and one was in JAMA. They couldn't produce their evidence. Went to the lead author, couldn't produce their evidence. And then one of the authors had said, it was on a computer that they lost and they couldn't find the computer anymore. I mean, imagine losing that data set. You know, it's kind of proper dog at my homework type stuff. So anyway, so we started kind of asking the same questions. And then I came across a whistleblower. We always like a whistleblower. And she'd worked for a medical writing agency, and she'd drafted all the papers. So the lead authors, not only did they not have access to the data, probably hadn't seen the data in the first place. And when we got internal documents from the European Medicines Agency and from NICE, the people on the NICE documents who said had done the trial were completely different to the people in the published articles. So we had no idea who was responsible for the data set. We had no idea who had seen the entirety of the data, other than probably Roche and GSK for zanamivir. But we focused on Tamiflu to start with, because that was the one, that was the blockbuster, that was the one that, you know, we spent £500 million on. And we spent probably more than anywhere else, because than most of the rest of the world, to be honest, and we were right up there. So this ghostwriter, and then she fed me her marketing plan. And what happens is, in when you do clinical trials, I mean, the marketing material matches up to the final publication. So they had key messages
running throughout, saying, you know, reduces secondary complications of influenza, reduces hospitalizations. Although we couldn't verify that was true because we couldn't see the primary evidence. The FDA in America said one thing, it was completely different to EMA. So who was right? Who's actually looked at the data? All the FDA said was it reduces symptoms by 21 hours, which, you know, it might help, but it certainly isn't the same kind of impact as reducing secondary complications as hospitalizations. But also, she sent me a copy of her CV because I wanted to make sure, one of my jobs is to verify whistleblowers and make sure that they're, you know, there's an expression, excuse my language, why is this fucker coming to me fucking now? And that's kind of, you know, what your first thing you're meant to ask kind of as a journalist, you know, what's people's agenda? So first of all, why is this person coming to me? So you ask, you know, what's your evidence of work for this company? She sent me a copy of her employment form. She was also ghostwriting for antiretrovirals and antipsychotics, I mean, a whole lot. But at this particular moment in time, we were focusing on Tamiflu. It was the pandemic. Now, also what she sent was all the marketing material she'd written. So if you ever go to conferences and you see the marketing material, grab it. It's great stuff for kind of later on, if you want to then go and expose it. So what was also on that marketing material, and I was looking at the names thinking, they were advising the DH, they were advising WHO, they were advising all these different people. They were key opinion leaders, they were there to market right from the outset, before even Tamiflu had its generic names. If clinical trials, phase two, it's still got some code name, phase three, it gets its generic name. They were starting to market it from phase two. They were that confident of getting onto the market. I spoke to an FDA insider. It was a political decision to get the drugs onto the market. They wanted something, anything for influenza, because the previous class of drugs did absolutely nothing. I can't remember what they were called. But anyway, they did absolutely nothing. They wanted something, anything, to be shown they were being proactive. And this is what the FDA insider told me. And he'd actually advised the FDA to reject the drug, and it was overturned higher up. And that was during Bush, I think, his presidency. And, you know, there's quite a lot of governmental influence on regulators, you may not be surprised to learn. So that was that. Then the next piece was like, well, what do we do with this? You know, we've got all this marketing material. You know, we need to, and mainly WHO that they've been advising, even by not WHO officials. So the next piece we did was, you know, conflicts of interest in WHO panels. The reason it was better to do it that way, to talk about conflicts of interest a lot, which, you know, you can debate whether they are or aren't an issue. But we'd already established the evidence base. We couldn't substantiate the evidence base. And we'd also spoken to people at Gilead, the company, the parent company, who sold it to Roche. And there was actually a spat between Roche and Gilead. And Roche were pissed off. They thought they'd bought a dud. So then goes into the marketing hype. And you start lobbying. They had ministers. They were speaking to the DH. They were speaking to Liam Donaldson when he was CMO. They were speaking to WHO. And they were actually kind of playing people off against each other. And it got to the point where I was told by someone within WHO that two African countries, there was one kind of flight apparently with Tamiflu on it, and two neighbouring African countries were fighting over who got this kind of supply of Tamiflu. They managed to create such hype around the drug. That then sparked off. Now, you guys, I assume, are, you know, into change, political change, kind of policy change. And this is kind of how, I guess, investigative journalism can tap into that and help push things forward, because the amount of substantiating, when I have allegations, I don't just write them down. If I've got allegations, I have to go to every single person I have allegations with. So my allegation, you know, so it's quite an exo. You'll see all the questions that I will give to Roche, or all the questions that I gave to, you know, the various kind of lead authors of the various papers, the allegations you put to WHO. And when it came to WHO, we went out to Geneva to interview them. And we did it kind of, it was early days of Bureau of Investigative Journalism. And it's an interesting situation. So I was interviewing one of their press officers, and we had the camera on them. They had the camera on me. And that's kind of typical, where you've got two-way cameras, or they will stick you know, a microphone in front of you and record everything you're asking. Because it's basically, I mean, it's like, we've got your eye on you, you put a foot wrong, we'll come after you. And so it's for their own records. So you're in quite an odd situation. I was in a situation, I did a story on a drug called Dabigatran a few months ago about how they withheld stuff from the regulators. And that's a drug that is kind of used, you know, supposed to do something to warfarin, not need monitoring. This particular story was about its use in stroke prevention and atrial fibrillation, non-valvular atrial fibrillation. And I had a conference call with the market and the head of comms, the medical director, the director of cardiology, the US law firm. There were five people on that phone call and me. And in that situation, kind of have to think, well, they're on the ropes here. I don't have to do or say anything. I'm literally giving them opportunity to explain and talk. So in those situations, your evidence gathering, you don't go and do the Jeremy Paxman type thing and pin people down. You want people to talk and you want people to say what they have to say. In this particular instance, I didn't put this into the investigation. Fee Godwin, the editor-in-chief, kind of asked me why later, but sometimes you hold things back because you know you're going to get attacked. And they'd actually lied to me about having done analyses that I had sitting on my desk next to me. And I was thinking, they're sitting here. I've got internal documents, and they've lied. But again, you held that back. And there was no point. They were already boring it in my hand that couldn't be made. They already looked pretty bad. So, you know, that I'd have had to avoid that in. And it was just good to know that there was more that I could put out if and when they came on the attack. So there's kind of all sorts of processes. Now, what kind of information do you think kind of helps? What kind of techniques do you think you kind of use as an investigative journalist? What are the kind of documents that, you know, come zinging into your inbox? You go, oh, all right, those.
Stuff about finances.
Yeah, well, if it's finances, you fall off your chair. I mean, that's kind of great stuff. But, I mean, stuff that you might come across, as kind of doctors, academics,
side effects.
Kind of, huh?
Trip side effects.
Yeah, if you've got any, but it's quite hard to pin that one down, whether you know it is a drug side effect or not.
It's case studies, personal stories.
Personal stories, yeah. So it's the kind of thing, has anyone actually ever worked with a journalist before on a story? I mean,
we just like short articles in local papers or they tend to ask case stories
and stuff, and that's all. If you work with the lay press, personal stories, you every time you do something you have to have a personal story to go alongside it. The anecdote is more important than statistic. Obviously in my world it's statistics that matter, and anecdotes are great, particularly if they haven't been counted, their deaths or bodies haven't been counted in clinical trials, which again happened with the Dabigatran stuff. I found two people, families of two, well, it was more than two people, I interviewed two people whose fathers hadn't been counted in the outcomes of the clinical trial, who died during the clinical trial, bled out, which is obviously the main side effect if you're trying to stop clotting, the main side effect is a bleed. So maybe
you don't use that
trial.
Stuff.
Huh?
You don't use that individual story.
Oh, I did in this one because it's, oh yeah, I mean,
okay.
There's an expression actually, it was Ian Chalmers, your head of Ian Chalmers. So Ian Chalmers kind of helped set up Cochrane, he's kind of, you know, he's kind of the Ben Goldacre kind of mould. He has an expression, and I think it's, I always keep it at the back of my mind, mortality data is data without tears. So when we're talking about mortality data in clinical trials, these are people who have died, you know, and it's quite easy when you're dealing with science and stuff all the time to forget that actually people have altruistically given themselves to a clinical trial, allowed themselves effectively to be experimented on, then it's only fair and right that they should have their deaths counted in the outcomes. They've contributed to society. So one way, in the back of your mind, I think the mortality data is data without tears. These people that have helped try to progress science and haven't had their outcomes for whatever reason counted. So it's kind of worth... So anything else?
Yeah, let's ask about the bigger show one.
Yeah.
What impact, or in general, do you find that... Do you ever sort of follow up and see what impact it has on the people that you're trying to...
Yeah,
it's
so the Tamiflu thing, this is what I was going to say, that's what sparked the All Trials campaign. Has everyone heard of the All Trials campaign? Access to data? So if you Google All Trials, it's a big campaign about getting access to clinical trial data. All data in clinical trials should be published. And the European Medicines Agency, from the start of next year, they have huge swathes of data, the regulators. So
So from next year, the European Medicines Agency is going to be publishing all their clinical trial data. So from the start, I mean, you can't say it was just that, but it was the thing that kick-started, and then Ben wrote his book, Bad Science, and picked up on a lot of the themes, and it became a campaign. And if you get enough people behind it, kind of saying enough's enough, it can be campaigning journalism.
So that's for something like time period where it kind of had a limited life anyway, because we kind of got over the whole food issue of it. But something like a bigger trend is still, you know, used in clinical practice all the time.
Oh, exactly.
And it's like, you know, they're deflecting it onto
And they brought up, I mean, trying to find people who are independent in this is kind of quite tricky in certain specialties in medicine sometimes. I know what the FDA are doing. I mean, I've been told that kind of, you know, you have insiders here, there, and everywhere. The more you do, the more you kind of get people to trust you and speak to you. I know the FDA think that they've stuffed up. They've admitted internally they've stuffed up. They did non-inferiority trials. In other words, they just said, is it as good as warfarin? Now, you want a drug that's better than warfarin. Why just put something on the market that's been around for 50 years that we know how to use really, really well as clinicians? You know, we know what it does. We know which some people don't respond to it. Why just do a non-inferiority trial? Why don't you try and get them to do a superiority trial and demonstrate it's actually better than warfarin? And they've admitted. And there was a recent advisory committee meeting where monitoring came up for the first time, and the fact that they should be looking for superiority. So the FDA basically admitted internally that they should have done superiority, which is what we were saying. You know, warfarin's responsible for more hospital kind of emergency admissions for a drug pretty much than any other. So surely you'd want to improve on the harms, which are major bleeds and fatal bleeds. So they've now kind of said internally, we're going to try and make the companies have to monitor that, which is the story I worked on, was that they'd withheld internal analyses that showed that monitoring would actually improve the side effects, would reduce the number of fatal and major bleeds by 30 to 40%, which is not insignificant. So I know that that's what they're talking about, but the regulators get themselves into a knot as well. They're political organisations. They don't always want to be seen to have done the right wrong thing. So sometimes it can happen really quickly. So a story I did about a diabetes drug called rosiglitazone and Vandia. 3 weeks after the story came out, the European Medicines Agency yanked it off the market. And that story was basically, and there's different ways of telling stories, but so often you look at what the regulators' concerns are before they put something onto the market. Those concerns then are later borne out. If you think about how you go and approach and regulate a drug, so you go and you say to a company, we've got all these concerns about your drug. So with rosiglitazone, it was cardiovascular outcomes. It actually increased cardiovascular events compared to, you know, to placebo. It's type 2 diabetes. That is the thing that you want to reduce the risk of. So They say, we've got these concerns, you know, increased risk of heart failure, actually increased risk of myocardial infarction. What's the company going to say? Damn, you're right, shit, we didn't see that one. They persuade the regulators that they're wrong. And they go, it's like asking someone to mark their own homework. You know, oh, you've got that, oh, well, no, I haven't got it wrong, because this is why I miss. You know, it's so time and time again, you see the same kind of themes emerging. So one of the big things that I use is a lot of FOI. Who's ever done a Freedom of Information request?
Hundreds.
Well, I've been answering them.
I've answered them, but I've never submitted one.
Okay, so you guys that have FOI ball emails, think carefully about what you're putting them. The gold dust to me. But obviously I'm trying. There is an absolute double standard there, in my view. You can't FOI private companies now. You know, the privatisation of the NHS, what kind of data are you going to be able to get out of them compared to what you can get out with NHS? Not a level playing field. So I use, and that's one of my kind of biggest concerns, because you just can't get that. You can't get that data out of companies. It applies to the public sector, government. You can't get it out of charities either. GMC, you can get it from. So it's those kinds of authorities, and it applies in Europe. Actually works
other, and government departments have got very slick. The story I'm working on at the moment, it'll be breaking in about a month probably, is a lot of FOI in the Department of Health and the Department of Business Innovation and Skills. Guess who determines what the government does, guys? Business, yeah. Shock. Biz are okay with that. Department of Business Innovation and Skills. They're like, yeah, that's fine, that's what we do, we're here to serve our purpose. The DH, on the other hand, can be slightly awkward for them. I don't know if you know, the DH is pretty much, Department of Health is pretty much split down the middle. So you have the lot that look after the NHS, and you have the lot that look after industry. And the two do not necessarily sit that easily. I had a story the other day that I was told by insiders at NICE that they're going to have to be much more favourable to industry because the new minister for NICE sits in the Department of Business Innovation and Skills. So NICE is going to be much more, and people inside NICE are really concerned and quite upset about it. They don't quite know how it's all going to break down, but it's all about the innovation agenda and supporting private business and lobby and all that kind of thing. Everyone, doing what a government department now is tricky. My brother's a civil servant, so he gives me a few tips. He works in the Department of Energy and Climate Change. So he gives me a few tips, but basically a lot of stuff they do now, everything's kind of on an instant messenger. So not much is an email. Clearly, you know, drug companies don't write letters and they have to log meetings. But where do you think in government levels where the power comes from? It's lobby firms. You know, Linton Crosby. If you heard of him, he was the guy that was Cameron's advisor, worked for tobacco. So a lot of it, and unfortunately a lot of that isn't logged. But I use a lot of freedom of information. Now that works a lot with the European Medicines Agency. So a lot of, and it's amazing, huge amounts from there. So a lot of stories I will look at what the European Medicines Agency were asking in the early days before a drug came onto the market. So what happened with Avandia is I pointed out right at the start, this drug has had all these kind of, you know, they've been investigated by the US government, the Department of Justice, the Senate Finance Committee for burying homes about Avandia. Guess what, Ema? You had concerns about this well before that drug was used in millions of people around the world. You kind of pointed that out in the report, and the drug was taken off the GSK share price, that's the one where GSK share price dropped. And they then yanked the drug. So FOI is another tool. Now the other thing that I use is discovery in the US. Now it always slightly bothers me that things go wrong in Europe, in the UK, and companies just, they get away with it, they don't get fined. You know, the NHS picks up the tab. So one of the stories I did was about metal on metal hips, you might have heard it. High failure rate compared to your standard hip, far more expensive. The initial procedure was more expensive. People have revision operations, there are metal on metal clinics in hospitals following up, looking at cobalt and chromium levels in people's blood. Now, high failure rate, the companies knew they were failing, and still they were putting them onto the market. Who's picking up the cost of revision operations and following up people? You know, people have been left with kind of disabilities because, you know, the revision operations can be a tricky procedure. Pelvis was dissolved from the kind of metal ions given off these hips. Who picks up the cost of that?
NHS.
Now in America, the Department of Justice wades in. And that's where you get, you know, when you hear about the big fines that companies get, you know, $3 billion that GSK got, for example, and it sounds like I'm really bashing for drug companies. I'm really not, it's just kind of, I'm an investigative journalist and they're just a really good source of stories. So Department of Justice. And also, what do America not have that we have? NHS. So people are out of pocket. And that's why you have these big kind of lawsuits and class actions in America. Now how that works is they will go to lawyers, lawyers will go to a judge, the judge will say, yep, we think you've got a case, and they'll do what you call discovery. So they will go to the companies and they will get, it happened with tobacco, so University College San Francisco had the tobacco archives where the tobacco companies were effectively sued in America. They got all their internal documents and UCSF have put them up on an archive. So in discovery, they go along, we've got this case against the company, they get all their internal documents, and literally there are millions and millions of pages. They have teams of lawyers and researchers go through all these documents looking for the stuff. Now, if you get public-spirited lawyers, and now a lot of these never see the light of day, they're used in plea bargains with settlements. You don't settle, we'll put out this embarrassing document into the public. But if you get public-spirited lawyers, and there are quite a few in the States, they will make sure as much of that gets into the public as possible. So that's obvious, that's a good sort of, but you develop kind of relationships with you. So the Dabigatran stuff started out as the analyses that a lawyer had given to me. Now, what am I thinking when a lawyer approaches me?
Danger.
What do you bloody want? You know where they're coming from. You know they're plaintiff's lawyers, but the agenda is quite clear. They are representing people that they believe, rightly or wrongly, have been harmed by something or other. So I know that when I get those documents. So what do I make sure I do?
Check the evidence.
Put everything to the various companies. Give them absolute full right to replies. Offer them, I don't know how many chances, to give any extra data, any extra information, any extra analyses that contradict what I have in front of me. Now, the excuse that Boring Ingelheim used was we can't possibly do that because we're in the middle of a lawsuit. Is that true? No, absolutely not. They can do whatever they want with their data. They could give me whatever they wanted to counteract the allegations that I was making, counteract the evidence I had. Absolutely nonsensical, because it's their information. So discovery in the United States, and again, you just get a sense that something's not right here, and you make a few inquiries. So it's when they go and get all the internal documents from companies.
So it's like, it's the equivalent of, is it an organisation?
No, it's an act. It's,
oh right,
it's
freedom of information.
It's freedom of information on a big scale, on a kind of corporate America scale. So if I go an FOI document, I might want a kind of minutes of a meeting that was held between such a minister and such a company, and that I will do that through. But I have to know that that's there to be able to ask for it. If you ever do an FOI, it's an absolute nightmare sometimes. You have to know what you're asking for before you ask it. Because if you do something that is too broad, then they'll throw it back at you and say, or they can interpret it in any which way you want. They want. Well, they'll throw it back at you and say, this goes above and beyond what we're expected to do. Guess what the Department of Health do quite a lot? They do that. They use every single get out. They over-redact as well, thinking that by the time I challenge the redactions, it's going to be months, years down the line before I've been able to get a kind of hearing with the Information Commissioner. So they'll push their luck all the time. I've just FOI'd the MHRA. Loads, over-redacted. There's enough there for me to work out to kind of substantiate what I thought had gone on, but they over-redacted it, knowing fine rightly that if you're not happy with your FOI response, you can go to the Information Commissioner, but knowing that takes quite a long time to do. So there's a lot of gaming, yeah?
I don't think anyone else in this room is an investigative journalist.
Yeah.
We may all have things where we think, well, it'd be interesting to get an investigative journalist working with us on this.
Yeah.
So how would you go about that?
Brilliant. I won't ask you, unless anyone wants to kind of give an example of something they might want looking into, and then I can kind of go to, yeah?
I was on a bus with somebody who was talking about his mother-in-law was in Taunton, and she had had her cataract operation postponed because of, she said the Taunton Health Authority had given the contract to a private hospital, and they had been open for 5 days when the Taunton primary care trust closed it because they had had too many.
That's a good story.
Well, I don't know.
A good story.
But it was just talking. I thought, well, if I had my
freedom of information, you should be able to get that, because all contracts over £25,000, you should be able to you know, for public sector, you should be able to access through Freedom of Information. So you will be able to get into Freedom of Information contract, you know, the contract for that particular service, where it went to, discussions about it. Now, they might try and use commercial confidence, but I don't think that, because there's kind of public interest, there's probably, you probably can't use that exemption. And then any discussions about what happens and what might, if it's over 25, yeah, you should be able to probably get the figures of that. And then what's happened to that contract, you should be able to get that through Freedom of Information. That is exactly the case. But you'd have to get it through the CCG, you'd have to get it through them, and FOI and the CCG.
But how do you know these outdated times of...
That's big enough for them not to. To have a whole cataract surgical department, the fact that is enough on that instance, I think, in terms of dates. It's more when I'm asking for a specific meeting. So, story I'm working on now, meetings between the DH and Novartis. Now, there's probably dozens of meetings. So I've got to be a lot more specific with my request. But actually, a cataract service being commissioned out to a provider, that's a pretty big deal, and that they'll know. Yeah, that shouldn't be an exemption.
That's one of the cataract surgeries are one of the parameters that you can get on the, I think it's even on the BBC website, where you can compare CCGs, compare how many patients they do, because it's one of the elective procedures, low priority procedures.
But is that something you could work with an investigative journalist?
Absolutely.
On,
how would you find
the person?
There's lots of different. Well, sadly, there isn't that many. So you can either go, depends on how local, how big the story is. Straightforward story like that, I mean, you could go, probably start with your local, you could try and go national, and you could try the Guardian, that might be kind of the kind of story that Dennis Campbell on the Guardian might be interested in that kind of thing. And to be honest, Gareth Iacobucci, who I work with at the BMJ, is fantastic with things like that. He's our kind of CCG, he did these. He had to look at all the conflicts of interest in CCGs between you and the gatepost. He's looking at the amount of money spent on private contracts at the moment. He's done an overall view, FOI'd up and down the country to get an overall view. Now, he'd be the kind of person. The local, depends what impact you want to have, the local kind of BBC reporters and stuff will be quite good on things like that. Depends how much digging that you wanted to do. Now, where I tend to find people come to me, it's where it involves data and stats and stuff like that, because of training in data and stats and kind of handling of big drug companies. And they know the thing, the likes of the BMJ, is they're going to be, it's all about health, so they're going to be interested in the story. Now, for a national newspaper or the BBC or Channel 4, it has to be big enough, the story has to be big enough to kind of meet the news agenda and make it up the news. It's about, I guess, finding people you feel comfortable talking with. And I've worked across kind of Newsnight, Panorama, Dispatches, etc., etc. And the reporters I know that I feel more comfortable with, and there are others that I think they just don't get it. So find somebody that tends to report on the kind of thing that you're interested in. If it's to do with harm, or basically, press are interested in stuff, dead bodies and money. Very, very crudely, that is what's gonna, because you have to think in terms of selling a story. Journalism, we can have all this idealistic kind of view of what it is, you know, speaking truth to power. But very crudely as well, it's the business of selling information. So every single TV channel will know exactly the ratings of everything they've watched. They'll look at Twitter to see who's tweeting what. They will know the exact impact that they're having. Everything is measured. Newspapers know what sells, particularly with websites. They know the click-through rates on everything. They know exactly what is hitting people. And so they'll have an idea of what stories that they want. I don't have to worry about that so much, fortunately, working where I do, just because it's, you know, it's weekly, it's about health. And so that's kind of less important, yeah?
I think so, quite a lot of our concerns can be quite local. They can be like the impact of a BFI on our local hospital. They can be, for instance, one of the nurses my husband's worked with who
your local journalists are desperate for people like you. In many ways, you've got the power. Now, it might seem that journalists have the power. Now, you make your initial approach and just keep it quite general, particularly local press. They're absolutely dependent on local people. Now, if you think your story taps into a much bigger theme, so it might be something, you know, that's happening with cataract surgery in Taunton, but it might be a much bigger trend across the country. You can then, that would be the point to take it to the national media, is actually I think this is a much bigger issue than a local issue, and that will be when the national media get involved.
But we don't necessarily know it's a national issue.
So before you, but I mean the thing you
maybe
have
the
to
journalists
have,
would do
the journalists might,
yeah.
but you have to have, if you kind of have to have a little bit of evidence before you approach
can you
the journalists.
Can you give us some examples of how we get evidence then? What sort of ways we get it?
FOI, email exchanges. You guys are undercover. Okay, you can ask questions of people. So a lot of what I get, so if you think about the Tamiflu thing, the story started off with Cochrane emailing the authors of other papers saying, can we have your data? No, 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 the dogs eat my homework, you know, it's been put through a shredder, etc., etc. Then they feed that to me. So a lot of, again, email exchange. This is why. But if you put an email, and it's always at the back of my mind, you have to assume it's going to get, you know, if you put whatever you want in an email, you wouldn't mind publishing, basically, because emails can just be forwarded on so easily. You can ask questions. If you try and ask questions and you get no response, then, you know, you say, I'm sorry, I hate to say, it sounds like I'm scaremongering, really not. But you can ask questions of people, just as a someone in the community that's concerned, or a doctor, or an academic, or someone like that. You can put stuff in email that I come. The minute I start asking, it's like...
What's the incentive for them to reply, though? Say she emailed her CCG commissioner in charge of...
That becomes part of the story.
Yeah, but what if they just don't reply?
But then you let the journalist know that.
That you've emailed and you got no reply.
You then become, you know, local woman tries to pin down. Think in terms of headlines. Local woman tries to put concerns in local hospital, gets no response from the hospital. You know, think in terms of, you know, we think in terms of issues. You kind of, what I would say is read what is written and you look at the angles. I'm obviously going in at kind of withheld analyses from regulators. If you think about the anecdote being so powerful, the case study, the anecdote, there's so many different ways into the story. You can approach a journalist and say, I'm really concerned, cataract surgery, I've tried to get a response, I've got no response. Can you, you know, what do you suggest? Can you help me? I think there's a story there. I think there's something more there. Now it's up to the journalist to then decide what they do and don't do. But you've got to kind of entice them in. You know, you need to kind of bring them in. Yeah, sorry.
When we're thinking about doing it, what is essentially
mm-hmm.
We've given advice about the sort of things you should try,
yeah,
and what you should do before you, and in a sense going to the media is agreed on as the last resort.
Yeah.
I mean, if you want to have money to your job, or something, you should have tried to complain through the formal channels and ask the right questions and so on. I suppose my question is, you know, when, because you quite like to hear about stuff earlier than before we'd.
I mean, it depends on the journalist. I like to think I'm responsible and, you know, I'm trained initially to be a doctor. I care about healthcare. I care about the NHS. So ultimately, I, as a reporter, I want what is the best for health and best for patient safety, patient outcomes, whatever. And that's my starting point. I'm not after a quick scoop. The stuff that I take on takes months and months and months and months and months to do. Now, you can tip someone off, because don't forget what I was saying about FOI. You know, there might be reports, there might be... There's also something else that you can do if you are concerned is data protection as well. You can make data protection access requests. So if you're concerned at stuff and you're not being taken seriously and people are disregarding you, you can do a DPA on that, on that particular thing, asking for all information. You can do that with anyone. What information, so what we did with my whistleblower with Tamiflu, we did a data protection act request from the company, so she got all, she did it, but we wrote it for her, to get all her information, to kind of substantiate the allegations.
Did she lose her job then?
She left.
So how
how do you do without losing your job? That's been going on in your program.
Well, I've got an example actually. It's not sort of